wakapiga kura. Hao wabunge wote 100% waende wapi? Nyumbani.
Kenya's fourth presidential hopeful, James Ole Kiyiapi. Ole Kiyiapi is the only candidate in the race without a political background and has never been a member of parliament. Prior to joining the race for the top seat, Ole Kiyiapi was the permanent secretary in the ministries of education and local government. His story does not end here. Under the ticket of the Restore and Build Kenya Party, Ole Kiyiapi is the only male presidential candidate with a female running mate. Ole Kiyiapi joined the list of well-established politicians who have already declared their intention to succeed President Mwai Kibaki. Having served for the last 20 years, Ole Kiyiapi finally left the reassuring career in the civil service to take a gamble in the political arena. But what motivated him to run for presidency? As a first-timer trying to venture into the murky political waters, how realistic are his chances? Having been in the public service for almost two decades, will his experience count? Or is he in the race just to make a political statement? Having emerged from a humble beginning that has now become synonymous with most of the presidential candidates, Ole Kiyiapi's early life is best remembered within the village setup where herding cattle characterized his order of the day.
I used to be a herds boy. I look after calves, and then I look after goats, and then after cows. And I went to Standard 1 the first time when I was 11 years old. I just used to play around with kids and very simple rural life. And sometimes we used to trade. It's called barter trade. My mom would take milk to her Kisi friend called Nyaboke, and then she would collect a sweet potato from there to come and feed us. That was my life. It was sometimes very difficult because sometimes there was no milk. And then and there was no food. So we then had to rely on either going to sell a cow to go and buy the food from the market, or my mother will go across to the Kisi community and then from her friends sometimes get some food to bring. So it was, as a child, sometimes that was the part that I didn't like, that sometimes you are not sure whether you will eat. You are not sure whether you will eat, and when you go and look after cows the whole day, you play, and then you come home and you don't know whether there's food. It was very stressful for children.
Ole Kiyiapi was born on the 17th of May 1961 at Osupuko location, Transmara district in the Rift Valley province. He joined Poroko Primary School in Transmara at the age of 11. His academic prowess was recognized at an early age when he was in class 2. And hence his teachers at the time recommended that he skips class 3 to join upper primary. Came the year 1977 and Ole Kiyiapi sat for his CPE exams, attaining a record 36 points and proceeded to Alliance High School. Later, Ole Kiyiapi joined Moi University, Eldoret, in the year 1988. He graduated with a Bachelor of Science degree in Forestry, attaining first-class honours. In 1989, he joined the University of Toronto for his PhD, and 4 years later, graduated with a Doctor of Philosophy degree PhD at just the age of 32. Once he returned to Kenya, Ole Kiyiapi taught at Moi University as lecturer from 1994 and in 2004 got promoted to the post of associate professor. Having experienced a remarkable and steady career path over the years, Ole Kiyiapi was later, in 2007, appointed Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Environment and Natural Resources, then moved to the Ministry of Medical Services in April 2008, and in June 2010, he moved to the Ministry of Education in the same capacity up to 2012, where he quit to join active politics. So what was the motivation for him to run for presidency?
I am in this purely, purposely, because I want to serve my country, because I love this country, because I want to contribute, and that's my message to Kenyans. It is for me a call. It's a call that the nation is calling all of us to duty. It is calling you, it is calling me, it is calling every single citizen of Kenya back to duty. We need to stand up as citizens, and we must not sit back and say, if I'm not running for president or if I'm not running for any office, then I have nothing to do. No. Those who are powering our industry are defending this nation, and those who are doing, managing our health system are helping us. Those who are managing our education system, those who are running our agriculture, everybody is contributing. So leadership just happens to be one component.
While serving as Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Education, Ole Kiyiapi faced a storm that almost cost his job. He was implicated in a multi-billion corruption scandal that involved the disappearance of 4.2 billion shillings that Treasury had set aside for free primary education funding. According to an audit report that had been conducted on the Ministry of Education, 4.2 billion shillings was unaccounted for under Kenya Education Sector Support Program. The report further stated that about 100 officers in the Ministry of Education were suspected to have taken part in the embezzlement. The revelations from the report threatened Professor Samongeri's political career, who was Minister for Education then, as outcries for his resignation filled the air. More calls were made for the Education Permanent Secretary James Ole Kiyiapi to resign, as he was the chief accounting officer at the time. However, Ole Kiyiapi dismissed the allegation, saying the 4.2 billion shilling scandal revealed by Treasury had absolutely nothing to do with him. Kiyiapi said he found the matter was already under investigations when he joined the ministry back in June 2010. In a spirited attempt to exonerate himself, Ole Kiyiapi affirmed that he joined the education ministry to clean the mess and not to take responsibility of the same.
What you want me to say, and I will not say, is that a junior officer has stolen, and you want me to come and say, sorry, I'm resigning because my junior officer has stolen. How do you, suppose you are sitting here and a clerk or a school head teacher steals money in one of the 20,000 schools, and you come to know that money was stolen. If that was to happen, then every PS and minister will resign.
The anti-graft boss at the time, Professor Lumumba, said there was embezzlement happening in the education ministry under the watch of Minister Samongeri and his permanent secretary, Professor James Ole Kiyiapi, and there was no way the duo could continue holding office.
I hold the view that in light of Chapter 6 of the Constitution, the minister and the permanent secretary in charge of the ministries should take responsibility and resign. And that if they don't resign, the Honorable the President of the Republic of Kenya should dismiss them. That is what is done in civilized democracies. You cannot continue to preside over a herd of animals where animals continue to disappear and you don't take responsibility. This organization, therefore, in the exercise of its other mandate of ensuring that there is integrity and ethics, is making a public appeal to the minister and the permanent secretary to resign by taking political responsibility.
Though the matter was brought to the floor of parliament by former Ikolomani member of parliament Boni Khalwale, a final report on the scandal is yet to be made public. And the professor has asked Treasury to disclose the outcome of investigations so that taxpayers can know who to hold accountable.
I have insisted on this before and I will insist on it again. It was the Treasury that released a report, an audit report. And I want Kenyans to know that that audit report was focusing on the period on donor funding, including government funding, for the period between 2005 and 2008. 2005, I was not even in government. I was still in the university. And I've just told you that I came into government in 2006, and I served in various ministries. So the audit was focusing on a time period when I was in other ministries, because it was between 2005 and 2008. I went to the Ministry of Education 2010, 2 years after the expenditure of the money. The reason why people confused, and it was PLO Lumumba who didn't do his job well, because had he done his job properly, then he would have, as the investigator, he was the director of the Kenya Anti-Corruption Commission. Had he checked his facts properly, he would have told people that the permanent secretary who was there at that time and the ministers who were there at that time were so and so and so and so. And it wasn't me. I was not there in 2008 in Ministry of Education.
One of the biggest challenges he has is that he doesn't register on the radar screen, on the opinion polls, he doesn't register. And that in itself makes him, opponents can easily ignore him. They don't even have to bother reminding Kenyans about the perceived scandals that may have taken place during his watch at the ministry. But again, I don't think personally you would actually blame on Kiyiapi for that. It would be unfair to say that he was actually responsible for those problems that were in the ministry.
Though the final report of the 4.2 billion shilling free primary education scandal is yet to be released, could the alleged involvement of Ole Kiyiapi in the scam water down his pursuit?
I think, and I've said this before, that corruption in and of itself cannot hamper the chances of any presidential candidate winning, or cannot make somebody lose the president in this country, because actually corruption powers Kenyan politics. So whether Ole Kiyiapi was implicated in a corruption, and as far as I can recollect, he was never prosecuted, he was cleared. So as far as I am concerned, and I'm not sure he was really implicated, it doesn't matter in as far as his presidential candidacy is concerned. It's a non-issue in terms of his candidacy, and to the best of my recollection, he has never been prosecuted on corruption. He has never been arraigned in court. So that's a non-issue. But it's also a non-issue because corruption is not really a determinant of when people, Kenyans, are thinking about their presidential candidate, at least so far.
When we just stand up and we say, oh, there's been corruption in the Ministry of Education, that James Ole Kiyiapi is the person behind it, that therefore he's not good for office, it doesn't help much. But if we talk about corruption and political office in this country, it doesn't matter. Kenyans have developed a very thick skin for corruption and corrupt leaders. We would actually not have the leaders that we have, because virtually all of them have been implicated or named in one sense or the other. So I do not think that that is going to change anything. Such things don't matter. We are a society whose values some wild animal has eaten. And therefore, regardless that our leaders are corrupt or not, we shall vote for them. And in a sense, they represent who we are. We are corrupt.
In his long life professional career, Ole Kiyiapi is credited for publishing lots of journals on forestry, environmental conservation, biodiversity conservation, land use planning, institutions in natural resource management, forest resources assessment, wildlife resources, participatory natural resource management processes, and environmental sustainability.
In the Ministry of Environment, I did 3 or 4 things. Number one, I was the one who made it possible to operationalize the Kenya Forest Service. The law was enacted in 2005. So by the time I went to that ministry, 2 years later, the Kenya Forest Service still did not exist. So by when I went there, I urged the then minister, Honorable Professor Kivutha Kibwana, that we needed to operationalize this. That was one of my first initiatives. Number two, I went and found a ministry that had no technical support or unit that was supposed to advise the minister in terms of policy. And within 1 year, I worked with the Ministry of Public Service and we established that unit. It is called the Environment Directorate. It is now there. I did that in 1 year. Number three, I went there and initiated the project of cleaning up Nairobi rivers. If you see this Globe Cinema roundabout, it was a messy place down below Kiyiapi Street. We removed almost 200 trucks of garbage accumulated over the years, and we converted the place into a park with the trees. Now you can go there, you can go and walk and enjoy it. It wasn't like that. We did it. I'm the one who flagged it off. I'm the one who managed it. By the time Minister Michuki came, we were already three-quarter done. We were already at the stage of planting the trees. But he came and gave me a very strong political backup, and I thank him posthumously for being a very proactive minister. I was very happy working with him.
Having had such an illustrious career, Ole Kiyiapi started harboring dreams of heading the highest office in the land. According to the electoral laws, any civil servant seeking political office must resign from public office at least 7 months before the election date. So on April 16, 2012, Ole Kiyiapi called it a day at the Education Ministry to concentrate his energies on becoming the fourth president of Kenya.
It is a matter of urgency, for which, when you hear the urge, you must respond without excuse.
After a two-decade spell in the civil service, will his long-term experience count?
Yes, my experience counts because, what is it? The country is always about education of children, and I was there. It's about food for the people. And I was there because environment is about food. Food security is environment. And it is, if you are doing agriculture, soil, water, it's environment.
Yeah.
So I have a good experience in that area. Mm-hmm. And then it's about health of the people. And I was there. Mm-hmm. You know, so I want to say that, you know, I was in academia, I was in the university, where, you know, ideas are generated that you can use basically to move the country forward in terms of research. So I think my experience in the public service will serve me well. One, because that's really where those are the movers. Those are the drivers of the economy, of the country.
One of the biggest things that you need to propel you to the presidency, as we've seen from past elections, is ethnic numbers. He doesn't, he starts from that disadvantage. So the issues of experience, it's unlikely that people care much about that.
Looking at it objectively, he has all it takes to become the president of this country. But again, you have to ask yourself, what are Kenyans looking for in a president? Maybe Ole Kiyiapi is a good candidate, but just like Peter Kenneth, their time is not yet. Maybe 2022, 2027. That's the time when Kenyans, probably after they've broken the ethnic barriers, the regional barriers, and are now looking at a person as an individual, as a candidate, what do they bring on the table? That's when you would say, then Ole Kiyiapi stands a strong chance of winning the presidency. So corruption does not really matter. His experience in public service does not really matter. Kenyans are looking at Ole Kiyiapi as Ole Kiyiapi as an individual, and they don't think, in as far as this election has been mobilized as a two-horse race between Raila Odinga and Uhuru Kenyatta, he stands even the slimmest of chances of becoming the president.
James Ole Kiyiapi's presidential bid in 2013 is not a bid that has got to be taken extremely seriously. For this year, I think what James Ole Kiyiapi is doing is that he is preparing himself to make a very serious bid to the presidency in the coming years. The same could be said of our good friend Peter Kenneth, that we keep on asking since the opinion polls keep on indicating that they are at 1%, at 2%, at almost nothing percent, why are they hanging in there? Today we forget that there were times when the opinion polls used to show that Raila Odinga was sitting at 3%, at 4%, and now he's a very serious contender for this office. So a person like James Ole Kiyiapi is still in the process of building his curriculum vitae. When you join that race in 2017, 2018, you must remember that you'll be joining him on a road that he has traveled before. But you will be coming on board as a starter. And he'll tell you, here we know there's a very sharp bend, there's a rickety bridge ahead, and he will have the immediate name recognition. That will be the time for us to interrogate his 20 years experience in government service.
Professor James Ole Kiyiapi, who harbors the presidential dream, rubber-stamped his Statehouse quest when he officially launched his presidential bid at KICC, saying that he would be nobody's puppet, but had a vision to transform Kenya. He pledged to address social challenges that have dogged the country since independence. While launching his bid, Ole Kiyiapi unveiled the Restore and Build Kenya Party as the political vehicle he intends to use to ascend to the country's top leadership. Ole Kiyiapi affirmed his commitment to the country and asked Kenyans to elect him, saying there is nothing more powerful than an idea whose time has come. But what is his vision for Kenya?
My vision for this country is very simple. We already have a vision, and it is called Vision 2030. Mm-hmm. It's a national blueprint. Mm-hmm. We have committed ourselves to that vision. Mm-hmm. I don't want to lie to people that I'm going to come up with my own vision called Ole Kiyiapi's vision. Who is Ole Kiyiapi to go and change the thinking of millions of other people? Mm-hmm. What I want to do, if and when elected president, mm-hmm. is to fire up that vision. I want to, my manifesto is not some, it's not reinventing the wheel. It's not coming up with the new things. Uh-huh. It is doing what we are already doing better. Uh-huh. And it is driving Vision 2030 implementation to another level. Uh-huh. One, in terms of aligning the resources properly so that Vision 2030 becomes a part and parcel of everyday affair of government. Uh-huh. We are moving in a certain direction. Two, put the muscle and tendons, tie the pillars together. Uh-huh. Put the flesh, let's tie the pillars together uh-huh. so that they are not just standing alone uh-huh. and we see it in terms of projects. Let us see it in terms of a complete philosophy that we are moving the society from this point to that point. And I want to work very hard with those in the secretariat to come up with that logic. Three, take it down to where the people are. Let the people see what we are doing and let them measure it. That this year we are here, next year we are there. And this year we are spending this much money, next year we are spending that much money. For me, I think if we can do that, Kenya will just go, we'll just move on.
Ole Kiyiapi is now competing with the well-established politicians. But as a newcomer in the political arena, how realistic are his chances?
I don't know how, but I'm going to win. And I'm going to win because when you speak honestly about things that matter to people, finally when the people look at us and say, which of these candidates do I trust? A lot of people are going to vote for us. Where we have a challenge is that sometimes we are not getting a fair deal. Uh-huh. And when you say free and fair elections, uh-huh. what you are doing right now is very good. Uh-huh. Zuku TV, you are doing a good job. Uh-huh. Because you are giving every candidate a chance to come and explain themselves. Uh-huh. Let the Kenyans hear us. Uh-huh. That's good. Uh-huh. But if you say it's free and fair and every day you are giving half of the news time to only two candidates uh-huh. in the name of coalitions. Uh-huh. And those coalitions were constructed only for the purpose of winning elections. Uh-huh. We have seen this before. Uh-huh.
We are now 50 years old as a country. Mm-hmm. We have seen people coming and winning elections, and they go back and do the same things they have done always. Mm-hmm. If that's what you want to do, I want you to put it on record, because you will remember my words, that even if they win again this time, 5 years down the road, you will still be complaining more than the last 5 years. We have to do something different. We have to completely dare and say, listen, we have tried this before, it didn't work, let's do something else. And this is how my freshness comes in. I am not a politician, and I don't think I will ever be a politician. I want to be called a leader.
I think I would bet that it's unlikely that by the time we are through this election, we will have President Ole Kiyiapi in place. This election is not his, and nothing short of possibly a major catastrophe that would wipe off all the candidates, or they decide that they've decided to give up to him. That's the only way, that's the only route he can become president. I can say that categorically.
Yes, 1 out of 10. I mean, that, and that's being very generous. He has absolutely no chance of becoming the president of this country at all.
Days after launching his presidential bid, Ole Kiyiapi unveiled his choice of running mate to the Kenyan public. With his choice being viewed as a strategic move on gender balance, Winnie Kaburu Kinyua was named as the first female running mate in the 2013 presidential contest. Ole Kiyiapi further said that his running mate had been chosen after a rigorous process and extensive consultation within and without the Restore and Build Kenya party. Though not a familiar face in the public eye, Winnie is an alumni of the University of Nairobi's Political Science Department. Winnie's a businesswoman and former vice chair of Kenya Private Sector Alliance, KEPSA. Winnie holds a degree in political science and a master's in gender and development from the University of Nairobi. So, by picking a female running mate, what qualities was Ole Kiyiapi looking for in his ideal running mate to make a dream team presidential contingent?
Quality number one is integrity. What somebody who stands on something, on certain values. Uh-huh. And Winnie has integrity, at least to the best of my knowledge. Uh-huh. Of course, no person is human, is perfect, not even, not I, not anybody else. Uh-huh. Number two, I was looking for, I wanted also to balance between the genders. Since I'm male, I wanted a female as a preference, but not at any cost. I was not going to just have a woman because it has to be a woman. I wanted a qualified, competent woman. Number three, somebody who was qualified, and Winnie is qualified. Mm-hmm. She's qualified in terms of education, educational qualification. Mm-hmm. She has 2 degrees, a master's and a bachelor's and a master's degree. Mm-hmm. A bachelor's in political science. So she will tell me about political theory and all that, and practice as well. Mm-hmm. But more importantly, I wanted somebody who is passionate about Kenyan people. Mm-hmm. And she's very passionate and very aggressive person, very motherly, and gets along very well. She interacts with everybody. Mm-hmm. She interacts with the small, what we call the small and the big, mm-hmm. the rich and the poor. But also somebody who is coming from and adding value to mm-hmm. the ticket. Mm-hmm. I'm bringing in the managerial skills. Mm-hmm. I'm bringing the sort of the public service experience, the government yes. experience side. Mm-hmm. She is bringing the private sector, mm-hmm. the business experience side. Mm-hmm. And that is a blend. That's a very strong blend. Mm-hmm. So for me, those were the considerations.
By picking a female running mate, RBK Party has demonstrated that women in Kenya are ready and can serve in big political positions. But will his move increase the stakes and boost his presidential chances?
It will boost it. It will boost it. Why? Because number one, Kenyans are tired with the current politicians. Uh-huh. In fact, they are tired. Uh-huh. It is just that they have a lot of money. I don't know where they got it from. And they're using it to mobilize, to hire crowds, to marshal it, to even to influence the media. That's why they get too much time more than others.
Okay, my biggest, on previous, another forums I've seen it argued that some of these candidates picked running mates who are what you'd call political minnows. People who have no, you know, if you are a weak candidate and then you also pick an equally weak running mate, It doesn't matter what whether the gender of the candidate. The fact that he picked a female candidate, possibly if he teamed up with a tough woman like Mother Karua, that would have made a difference. But this one, I don't think it will have much of a significance in this campaign. And I don't see even the value that the running mate that he has picked, I don't see the value that the running mate brings, how much value the running mate brings on that ticket.
Having emerged from a humble beginning and growing up in Transmara, what were Ole Kiyiapi's experiences that may have shaped the view of the country he wanted to live in?
The experiences I had when I was a small boy, when I was a small child, are pretty much still common in many parts of Kenya. There are still children in very many, many, almost everywhere in Kenya who are stuck, who are were brought up in those very, very difficult, humble, or even sometimes very difficult backgrounds, or what you might call poor backgrounds, and who are struggling to find a way in life. And for me then, I started asking questions, especially when I was a lecturer. I started asking questions, why are we not transforming? You know, if I started the class, the first class I went to was under three. Why is it that now Kenya is almost 50 years of independence, we still have some parts of Kenya where children are going to school under trees? So for me, I can relate very directly with the struggles that I see in the rural parts of Kenya. Like when I see on television people being given food in Ukambani or in Turkana during drought season, drought years.
Questions have been raised over Ole Kiyiapi's candidature, with his critics arguing he started climbing the tree from the top. With the senator and governorship positions being cited as the most suitable positions to start with, can Ole Kiyiapi prove his critics otherwise?
Why would you want me to go and waste time becoming? You see, if I want to be a governor, becoming a governor is not a small job. Running a whole county is not a small job. Becoming a member of parliament and representing a constituency is not a small job. Also, running a ministry of education and a 140 billion budget is not a small job. Which of the following people who are contending for president has managed a budget as big as I have? Directly, not proxy through the PS, but themselves manage. So when we talk about you should have, no. That means, it's a contradiction, because the Kenyans are saying, we are tired of this. We want something new. And then now you are telling me to go and learn the bad manners first, and then I come and give something fresh. No. I am offering myself because I feel this is the right time. I'm now 51, going to 52. You want me to wait again and wait again? This is the time. This is the time to offer myself, my generation. This is the generation. This is my generation time to give the best we can give to our country.
No, you know, Ole Kiyiapi's candidature is very interesting, because the moment he started, you remember when he was a PS for education, for a long time he kept saying that he's going to be a presidential candidate. People didn't take him seriously. Even when he came out, ultimately he resigned and he started campaigning, people kind of dismissed him and started saying that he's been given the stiff constitutional requirement for a presidential candidate, that you need to have at least 2,000 members of your party petitioning or signing a petition for you to be a presidential candidate in a half of the counties in the country. You know, it's a big feat to, it's something that people assumed may not be able to meet that. He meets it, and he seems to be actually something of a surprise. And when you look at him also, when you listen to the man talk, like during the presidential debate, and even in other, he seems like actually a different kind of a candidate that gives a fresh breath of air, if you can call him so. So he's a different candidate. He may not make it this time, most likely he will not, because even when you look at the opinion polls, he's so far off from the radar screen. But he's one of the people, because he ages on his side, is one of the candidates that are likely, if he maintains that tempo in the next election, he may be a major player. But for this one, he may not have much influence.
Ole Kiyiapi's RBK party has not formed alliances with any political party and insists he will go it alone all the way. So why is Ole Kiyiapi without an alliance?
Because the alliance were made for the purpose of winning and not for the purpose of empowering Kenyans. What we say as RBK is that we are not opposed to forming alliances, but we want to form an alliance after the elections. Why is that important? Because you will be talking to each other based on the mandate of the Kenyan people. It is out of respect for the Kenyan people rather than our own selfish interests that we refuse to do that. Because it's the same method we have used before. You know, you bring your alliance, I bring my, you know, you bring your community, I bring my community, he brings his community. Then we form an alliance. It's all about numbers. Then we win. Then so what? The next time you break it again, then you form an, you come up with another permutation, another combination, then you win. So what? When will it be the responsibility of the Kenyan people? Wananchi wa kawaida.
What qualities make Ole Kiyiapi better qualified than any other candidate in the race?
I don't know why the others are running. The only thing I do know is that I'm running and I'm doing this because I have passion for this country. I love this country. I will do an honest job. I have always tried to do an honest job. I will truly serve the Kenyan people. If that makes me the best, I don't know. It's the Kenyan people to judge that. But mine is to say, if given that honor and the chance, I will truly give my very best in terms of service to my country.
If opinion polls are anything to go by, then latest opinion polls by Infotrack have not done any good to Ole Kiyiapi's candidature. With a popularity rating at just 0.1%, can Ole Kiyiapi shock the world and overturn the pollster's verdict?
The poll that says that Professor is scoring less than 1%. What is it based on? What reality is that based? Because science, my friend, is a mirror of reality. It's a mirror of reality, okay? The ground must mirror that. Why are Kenyans, for example, saying Kiyiapi cannot get 1%? Well, you know, according to the pollsters. Because if the Kenyan people are selecting leaders on the basis of ideas, are you saying that I don't have ideas? Have I not been talking about ideas that are important to the people of Kenya? If you are saying that people are voting because of tribal blocks, why wouldn't even my own block then give me 2% or 3%? I think this is why I'm unhappy, because I feel this election is already being rigged. And it started a long time ago. Some are using pseudo experts to tell us that these numbers, all the people of this region will vote this way. How do they know? How do they know that the people of Kenya have already made up their mind? And if they have, why are we going for elections? If people have already decided. See, they just tell us they decided, we just count the blocks and then we go. You know, others are using pollsters and they say, keep that candidate there. Keep him down there. Don't let him come out. Just keep him there.
What is Ole Kiyiapi's take on the use of opinion polls in Kenya?
Opinion polls in Kenya right now are being used, they are being abused. I have no problem with scientific polls, objective, well done. And I say it because it's a new thing in Kenya. Let us all work together to build what we call the methodology. Because Kenya is not the same as America, and it's not the same as Europe. So a standard sampling method that you use in a fairly homogeneous, we say almost uniform population, like, you know, where people are very well aware of issues and where people are voting because of the issues and nothing else. That kind of method cannot apply in a situation where people are voting for different reasons. They're voting because of my tribe, they're voting because they are aware, they're voting because of issues, they're voting because some of them are influenced by other things. So when you reach that kind of situation, you will do what is called stratified sampling. Stratified sampling is that you cluster the people. But we need the pollsters to come to every campaign and say, hey, look, we want to do this thing in a way that will make everybody happy that it is science. Give us your expert. And I've told them before, how many people, I mean, there are about 8 presidential candidates. And maybe even some are not interested. But if they ask all the 8 of us, and we just give them 8 people, and they sat together, they designed the questionnaire, they agree on the methodology, they agree on the sampling sizes and all that, and then even the analysis is done openly, why don't they want to do that?
How does he envision his first 100 days in office?
In the first 100 days, I had said this before, but I want to make sure we declare youth unemployment a national disaster and come up with a very serious Marshall Program or plan, looking at number one, immediate interventions, things that you can do immediately. There are things that are possible right away, and those include things like opening up internships, looking at short contracts in various sectors, in environment, of course in the private sector, in agriculture, in tourism, look at everything, including construction, public works. Look at things that are happening, but do it, make sure that it's aligned to things that are already building towards the Vision 2030. Number two, look at the long-term aspects. Long-term aspects are things like education and skills, training, and opening up the economy, growing the economy. Because in the end, job creation is not just a national issue. It's an international issue. Every country struggles with this. But the real solution is more investment, you know, creating more jobs, as in the economy is growing. And you have to do this, again, long term.
In his first 5-year term, how would Ole Kiyiapi like to be remembered?
I would like Kenyans to look back and say that he really tried to bring us together. This man has worked so hard to pull the nation together. And he has also helped us to make progress in terms of education of our children, in terms of health of our people, in terms of food security or agriculture, in terms of the economy. I want the Kenyans to feel good about themselves. I want everybody to say, look, you know what? I have not reached there yet, but I can see hope now. We are going in the right direction. I would like to be remembered for that. If I can achieve that, that Kenyans will feel confident and have a great sense of hope and purpose that their country is moving in the right direction and that the government is accountable, I will be a very happy man.
What are the odds tacked against Ole Kiyiapi's candidature?
Okay, he has had sustained campaign since he resigned from government, from civil service. But the biggest odds that he has is in terms of resources. A presidential candidate is a very major undertaking that requires a lot of resources. He doesn't have the kind of resources that other major candidates, people like Uhuru Kenyatta or Raila Odinga, or even Musalia Mudavadi, or even Peter Kenneth for that matter, have. He doesn't have that. And then also the other disadvantage, as you pointed out, one of the other disadvantages is that he doesn't have a political background. That works both for him and against him. It works against him in the sense that he doesn't have the kind of network you establish over time. It works for him in the sense that is a fresh politician, he's a newly minted politician. So he can maybe, if he had a very soft campaign, like the kind of campaign Obama had in the US, he can actually become and come and overturn the tables. But as of now, we've not seen much evidence of that. He doesn't have a good campaign, he doesn't have that kind of a swerve campaign, and he doesn't have the kind of resources that would propel him to become number one.
The only roadblock, in my view, is the Kenyan people themselves. If the Kenyan people themselves decide it is somebody else and not myself, then I can't go to State House. So I don't worry about the polls. I don't worry about my competition. I only worry about one thing, the decision of the people of Kenya, if they can trust me. And I'm telling them to trust me. And I think as they get the messages, as we go to the debates and speak about ourselves, finally people are going to reach a point of saying, do we really want to change, or do we want to do this pretty much, you know, the same thing we have been doing? Because I really come on this on a platform of real change.
The odds are very clear that this election has been mobilized, and this is a fact that Kenyans never like confronting. This election has been mobilized on ethnic and regional considerations, so that the reason why Uhuru Kenyatta and William Ruto came together is because they believed they had what has been called the tyranny of numbers. They believed that if you bring the Mount Kenya vote, which is being said to be almost 4 million votes, and you bring the Kalenjin, which is almost 2 million votes, you begin this race out of the 14 million registered voters with about 6 million votes. That gives them a head start. That, if you look at the Raila Odinga side, the CORD side, also again, you look at Raila thinking about Nyanza, 1-point-something votes, Kalonzo bringing in Ukambani, almost 1 million votes, and the coastal regions and all that stuff. And of course, we have Wetangula trying to bring in Western vote. So the election has been mobilized on a regional and ethnic platform. And Ole Kiyiapi, coming from the Maasai community, doesn't pack any numbers at all. That does not mean he's not a good candidate. It just means that the way this election has been packaged and mobilized, it's unfortunate that he matters little in this race.
For the country were a society that was interested in change, it would be looking at two candidates in particular very seriously. One of them is James Ole Kiyiapi, and the other one is Mr. Dida, because they come completely free of a burden of claims of anything that they may or may not have done in the past. Such would be the people we were looking at if we wanted to sweep with a new broom. Unfortunately, that's not what we look for. We look for things like, is this person from my tribe? How many alliances of how many tribes are in the alliance in which he or she is leading? What are the numbers that are inside there? Does this person have huge sums of money? Is he or she generous with those freebies and giving them to us? Those are the things that we look for. And therefore, if Jesus Christ were to arrive here tomorrow morning, and somehow he was allowed to contest in this election, and he said that the assets which I bring to this election campaign are values and good assets of good leadership, we would not vote for him. We vote for people who corrupt us and for people who are from our tribe. If you combine those two together, that one, you are very rich, and two, you are from the correct tribe, then half of your work is done. I'm afraid that is not done for Ole Kiyiapi.
Ole Kiyiapi is a family man, married to one wife and has two daughters. But how does he manage politics and family?
How do I balance them? I give them time. My family is involved in this. I've not separated them from this. They are part of it. We are together in this. We are pulling together. So even when I'm down, they know I'm down. And when they're also down, I know they are down because we are together. That's number one. Number two, we're actually closer now than we have ever been before. We pray together. We discuss together. We encourage each other together. How do you feel, your little children who don't even understand the polls watch and they are told their dad is always number last, and they know their dad is not like that. It hurts them. So you keep telling them, sweetie, don't worry. Let's keep going. But you know that they are trying to be strong, but it's hard because the world is very brutal. It's not always fair, because if it was fair, then it wouldn't be like that. But we keep going. So my family has been my biggest pillar, my biggest support. And I've also been their support, and we said we'll hang in together no matter what happened, before, during, and even after. So for me, they are my biggest strength.
Growing up in Transmara, what are the fond memories of Ole Kiyiapi's youth?
I have so many fond memories. I was also a warrior, and the process of becoming a warrior meant that we had to stay one time in the forest for 3 months without seeing your mother. Or your dad, your dad, men came to see us. So we were actually staying in our house in the bush and chasing after birds. And that was a big training, though. And I think it's responsible a lot for a lot of the things, because you learn. It was a very difficult life of, you eat well, yes, but you're subjected to so many difficult things. By the time you come through, in a sense, you feel toughened. That was fun, though. It was a lot of fun, and I always, that is always very vivid. I mean, it was like a time of exclusion, and yet you are excluded in the rough. Whether you are sick or what, your mother cannot see you, and they will come there, and when they come and bring you food, they will say, "We have brought the food," and then all you can say to signal them that you have had is to whistle. You are not supposed to speak to her and say yes. You whistle. Then they leave the food near the gate of the bush house. Then you go and pick it and come and eat. And that too is a very, very interesting memory. It's done a lot by the Kalenjins and the Maasai. It's a cultural thing. But it's not happening anymore because you cannot afford 3 months in the bush. So I lost quite a bit of my time when I was going to class five, from class five to six. So I lost the whole of first term. God has really been good to me. First term of standard six, I lost it out in the bush, and nobody cared. The schools were open, nobody cared. They say, sorry, you fellows have to stay until end of March. Yeah. From December until end of March.
What is the most secretive thing about Ole Kiyiapi that Kenyans and the world do not know about?
I don't think there is a. I think the only. I don't think it is secret, really. I think the only thing that I want to repeat, because I've said it before, but I would like Kenyans to know, is to say that for me, this is a calling, and I'm not doing this just because I'm looking for a big thing for myself. No. For me, this is a specific calling. And I don't know whether that's a secret, because I've said this before, but I want them to know that it is not just a political ambition. It is not a political ambition. It is an honest endeavor to stand up for our country at a time like this, when it is truly demanding of all of us to stand for it, and especially those who would dare to be leaders. Really, that's for me, is perhaps the thing that is not coming out strongly enough, because that's why people keep asking me, why don't you first go and become an MP? Why don't you first go and become a governor? It's because they think this guy is just interested, you know, he's just jumping to, he wants to be president. No, go slowly. It's not like that. It's a season thing. When you get a calling to do something, you wake up and do it. And even if, you know, it doesn't happen, at least you will say, I stood up and I did something. I didn't just complain.
One of the greatest quotes on leadership by the late Albert Einstein says, out of clutter find simplicity, from discord find harmony, in the middle of difficulty lies opportunity. As a first-timer in Kenya's politics, can Ole Kiyiapi's candidature defy the odds and see the light of day? The Road to Statehouse analysts' interviews were shot at Classic Mouldings. Classic Mouldings, bringing spirit and soul to interiors across Africa.